Good evening. Welcome to this reading with Geetha Iyer. I am being joined on the screen now by the other people who are part of our evening with us. And then I will tell you a little bit more about our evening. Here we are. My name is Elizabeth Dark, and I'm Associate Director of Programs for the Kenyon Review. And we are very happy today to have Geetha Iyer, Kenyon College's Mellon Science and Nature Writing Fellow with us. Sergei Lobanov-Rostovsky is going to introduce Geetha in a moment, and Anastasia Langner, a Kenyon Review Associate and Kenyon College student, will be joining us for a panel, or not a panel discussion, but a Q&A discussion afterwards. And before I pass it on to Sergei, I just wanted to make a couple of announcements. If at any point you have a question that you'd like us to ask Geetha at the end of the evening, please use the Q&A feature at the bottom of your screen. If you would like closed captioning, you can get that by clicking on the CC button, and then you can change the size and the location of the transcript to your liking. Sorry, that's my dog over here. And let's see, there during the chat, yeah, if there's anything you would like to say during the evening of praise or adoration, feel free to put that into the chat, because that is open to everyone as well. And again, thank you for joining us tonight. I will come back later with Anastasia, but I will now send it over to Sergei to introduce Geetha.
Hi, everyone. I'm Sergei Lobanov-Rostovsky, and I'm the associate editor of the Kenyon Review. And it's my pleasure tonight to introduce Geetha Iyer, Kenyon's Mellon Science and Nature Writing Fellow. In the fall of 2016, the Kenyon Review published a special issue entitled The Poetics of Science, in which we brought together a diverse collection of poets, essayists, and fiction writers who shared an interest in the ways in which writing about science can be a literary art. At that time, Kenyon's program to develop classes in science and nature writing was still in its infancy. Professor of biology Chris Gillen and I would teach the first science writing workshop in spring of 2017. But we were already talking about ways to bring a science and nature writer to campus to teach courses and to help us imagine a larger program in this fascinating discipline. In 2019, Kenyon applied for a grant from the Mellon Foundation to do exactly that. And in 2020, we set about searching for the first Mellon Science and Nature Writing Fellow. We could not have imagined then that we would find someone as ideally suited as Geetha Iyer to bring together the rigor of science and the creative imagination in ways that would help us reconceive our program and our vision of the field of science and nature writing. Geetha has a multidisciplinary background in arts and sciences. She writes fiction, poetry, and nonfiction that focus on the intersections between the sciences and the arts through eco-critical and post-colonial lenses. She received an MFA in Creative Writing and Environment from Iowa State University, as well as a Master's of Forest Resources and Conservation with a focus on environmental education from the University of Florida. Her work has appeared in a wide range of journals, including Gulf Coast, Orion, the Missouri Review Online, Ninth Letter, Mid-American Review, Territory, Cold Mountain Review, The Account, National Geographic, the Massachusetts Review, and Indiana Review. Recognition for her writing includes the 2016 O. Henry Award, the 2014-2015 James Wright Poetry Award, the 2013 Calvino Prize, the 2012 Gulf Coast Fiction Prize, a work study scholarship from the Breadloaf Writers Conference, and the Hopwood Award and Robert F. Howe Prize for undergraduate short fiction from the University of Michigan. She's held residencies through the Sci Arts Initiative's virtual cross-disciplinary program, The Bridge, Experiments in Science and Art, Estudio Nuboso's Collaborative Art and Science Lab in Panama City, Panama, and the Sitka Center for Art and Ecology in Oregon. It would be impossible for me to give you a sense of how diverse her writing projects are. She is currently working on several book-length projects, including a collection of nonfiction essays titled Interstitial Organisms About Novel Ecosystems, Cognition in Non-Human Animals, and Finding Meaning in Human-Altered Landscapes Through the Lives of Animals, Familiar and Strange, a poetry collection, Mapping the Tongue, which started with a Tamil dictionary, a recipe for curried bananas, and scientific papers on invasive species, and is now concerned with all the ways language cannot classify experience. A novel in stories, Resident Aliens, about a family fracturing as they search for different ideas of home on Mars, in the West, in the woods, in the past. And a short story collection titled Waters, Fires, Houses, about natural history archivists, sociopathic artists, girls who might be time travelers, and languages that might be alive. One thing that all of Geetha's writing has in common is that its many forms of language are alive with energy, imagination, passion, and creativity. Please join me in welcoming Geetha Iyer.
Thank you, Sarah. That was a very generous introduction. And thank you all for joining me this evening. I am going to be reading from the excerpt of a short story tonight. It's called Water, Fire, House. There are three characters in this story, a lexicologist, a man who's been archiving dying and dead languages in his home / word library. The other is Meroa, an old woman who is dying at the start of the story and who we meet only through flashbacks as she assists the lexicologist in his work of word extraction and preservation of the rare languages that she knows. The third character is the word child, a glowing, toddling, shape-shifting monstrosity that Meroa somehow made out of the scraps of her first language. This story is written and narrated in English, but all languages represented within the story come alive when characters speak their names. They flutter and glow like fire beetles and can weave together into strands and nets and remain alive only as long as there are people around to remember them. So we begin. Even as the lexicologist lifts the tarp, he realizes it will not serve for a shroud, for it is water-stained and furry with mold. I know, he says to the word child by his side, don't look at me like that. The word child appears to understand. It drops its head and its shoulders slump. Perplexed, the lexicologist picks it up by grabbing it awkwardly under its armpits. It weighs nothing, but as the lexicologist presses his fingers into its body, his skin tingles against some kind of cold resistance. Why are you not dead? He wants to ask it. Meroa is gone. The word child looks down and waggles its feet. All right, he says, as you are. He lets it slip through his hands and turns to the stairwell. He knows the creature will pad after him. He makes his way down to Meroa's quarters, the bedroom she had insisted she didn't need. She'd cringed away from the walls because they were papered in floppy crimson flowers. Hibiscus, he'd said to her, as if that were an explanation. It occurs to him now that perhaps her reaction was not disgust, but a rejection of the lunacy. Why were the flat walls painted at all if flowers were desired? She had complained about the windows, how she could hardly see through them. She had remarked on the closeness of the fence around the refuge, how there was neither space nor depth in the rocky soil for a garden. She had tried to scrub away the grime, to draw back the curtains in every room she dared enter. Could he lay her to rest in the aviary, he wonders. He looks down at the word child. She'd say the view was not going to help her much anymore, would she not? The word child's face dimples, enervated perhaps by his attempt at conversation. Do you know where her brother is? He continues. It is madness, he realizes, a conversation tumbling into madness because Meroa is gone and with her everything she had learned and that he had tried to absorb from her. He wishes he were dead too, yet he has to lay out the last friend he will likely ever make. Do you want to be my friend? He asked the word child, sweeping through the first floor corridor, flinging open doors in his wake. The house needs an airing. Sunrise through the windows next morning. Perhaps he will light a big fire in the coastal hall. The signal flare of a shipwreck. Something to keep him company this long and terrible night. Something to keep his pet ghost entertained. Are you a ghost? Is that it? He calls over his shoulder. The word child pauses at every door and peeks in. Yes, yes, your siblings, all dead, or nearly so, he says to it. Come along. At Maroa's bedroom door, he hesitates before turning the handle. The walls are high and the furniture finely made. The bed is large and untouched but for its top covers, which Maroa had fashioned into a hammock that she'd slung into the window nook. Far below, the village slumbers under newly installed streetlights, a quilted glimmer of shingles and corrugated steel. Maroa's satchel hangs from a hook behind the door. It feels wrong to turn out its contents on the bed, but the lexicologist wonders if it might contain a clue, an address, a photograph of some next of kin, or a dried out mushroom conch, a felt booklet of needles and small coils of thread, a small wad of money, and a waxy gray pebble that, upon sniffing, turns out to be a piece of soap. The lexicologist sinks to his knees. The bed has four polished posts that end in carved heads. They seem to scowl at his weakness. The word child clambers onto the mattress and pokes at each of Moreau's belongings in turn. It suddenly sits up straight and beckons to the lexicologist. He is too shocked to protest. He shuffles about the bed frame as it scrambles across the mattress to dig under a pillow. As he pulls the pillow away, he sees the creature seep through the seam between mattress and headrest. He thinks he hears whispers under the bed. He begins to crouch, but a telltale glow suggests that the word child has already found what it was looking for. It mushrooms out of the hairline gap behind the mattress, reforming as it does so, pulling with both hands the unmistakable glowing tendril of another language congealed from word scraps that Maroa had decided to stash behind the bed. He had thought it harmless enough when Maroa started whispering to herself, absently stroking the refugee's walls and fighting and fingering doorknobs she never seemed to want to open. It was when he couldn't find her for three consecutive days that he began searching, stumbling upon her at last in the room where he'd stored her language along with all its nearest relatives. "What have you done?" he yelled, for the room was aglow, drawers pulled open, bell jars overturned. The bottom of Maroa's smock was neatly lined with pins she'd taken out of the cabinets. Words flew free in the air around her. She'd lived there for nearly a year by then and had never once attempted anything so egregious. The lexicologist had settled into a rejuvenated work routine, attempting to catalog everything that Maroa had shared with him. There were never any complete stories. Her brother wore the top half of a military outfit to his wedding because the lovers were parted during the Great War between. She might have been old enough to have birthed him, but her mind was supple and rambled like vines in a squash patch, from some historical note of interest to some opinion about the way he stored his books. She had taken to ordering them, not by alphabet, but color and size, just to keep them off the floor. He, in turn, had tried to teach her to sound out the Queen's tongue by letter, and he pointed out that the titles of books would be a way for her to practice. He'd shown her the ship's registries he'd collected. They lined an entire wall of a small storage room and would have taken weeks of work to search through, even for someone who could read. But if Maroa's brother had boarded any of them bound for work to the island colonies, this would have been the way to find him. B-A-S-H-O-A, he'd written out for her. That was what to search for, he'd explained. There were thousands of men who'd put down their names. She could stay as long as she needed, he'd said. It was good for them both. Had she learned anything, he often wondered. In her spare time, she hiked the slopes around the refuge, picking berries and succulents that she would turn into decoctions, as she called them. When the weather was uncharitable, she wandered about the house in search of things she might understand or at least keep tidy. But whenever she squinted at the labels on his cabinet drawers, he sensed it was out of frustration that everything could be so neatly pinned and packed away, so easy to find, even though her brother had been lost to her for 8 years. She considered it illogical. Now she stood in the Eastern Lowlands room, little better than a vandal, he thought, disemboweling a battlefield corpse. Attempting what, he demanded, his voice trembling with rage. I didn't think it was correct, she said in a small voice. The words she'd set loose quivered, casting dapples upon the floor, the walls, her shapeless smock with that twinkling pin-fringed hem. Look, she said suddenly, casting about her feet before seizing a ropey, glowing jumble from between two cabinets. Careful, it's slippery, but look at it, she said, holding it up for him. A snarly, indecipherable mess. But she grew animated as she tried to explain. The root of it, the way to put it all together, it's here. She teased through the tangled words she'd spun together. How had she done it? And they writhed through her fingers, and the air glowed, and the cabinetry shivered, and the room sounded like a whitewater as she babbled on, parting the language she'd reconstructed to show him the first words any person ever learned. Mother, she said. Hungry? Look, my child. Milk. Here. There. eyes, tummy, toes, come, beloved, sleep, your father, word upon word enmeshed, a time progression, till they wound themselves into cords that snaked Moroa's arms, trying to reach for the words that flitted loose around them. Put it down, he finally said. He spoke in Queen's tongue instead of her first language, wary of what might happen if he added his voice to the room's glow. Please come away from it for just a minute. The thing squirmed as she placed it gently on the floor. He doesn't like to be left alone, Moroa said, but the lexicologist shushed her as he backed out of the room, not taking his eyes off her creation. It flung out tentacles to try and grab onto Moroa's ankles, but she must have noticed the lexicologist's expression. She whispered something to the word mass, causing it to subside. By the time the lexicologist shut the door to the Eastern Lowlands room, it was but a puddle of a thing, seeping morosely across the floor toward an uncorked bottle, into which it sunk a limp proboscis. He shivered. I can't take it apart, Moroa whispered. It doesn't want... Do you know how I came to this profession? The lexicologist interrupted. She shook her head. Of course she couldn't have known. He had been like her once, naive to the world's complex order, willing to attempt any reckless thing just to see what would happen next. Even as Moroa tried to protest, he hushed her, drew her by the wrist to follow after him, for he needed to show her the seriousness of her transgression. He'd been at university, he explained, just like every other man, young man of means, trying to find some unmapped territory to explore. He'd had an instinct for languages, even as a youth. Pattern recognition, that's all it was. But he found, to his dismay, that anything of sense that might be said about the Queen's tongue and its birth in the vulgar patois of the world's greatest port city had already been written, catalogued, and put away. I turned my sights to the world across the ocean then. Every day, news and exhibitions and publications put together from the latest discoveries. I had access to the most extensive library and museum collections in the world. Can you imagine? He stroked the dull wallpaper of the corridor as they passed, his finger tracing the pattern of leaves upon it. Illustrations of trees, pressed flowers, stuffed birds with tags tied to their feet, vials of nearshore fishes with labels explaining the true colors of their scales and fins before they turned vinegar yellow with preservative. He turned to face Moroa. Everything you have a word for in your own tongue barely begins to capture this foreign alien familiar. We had to invent new names to describe everything or borrow names from local tongues. It was how I came to study language evolution, he explained, descending the stairs heavily as if he could hardly lift his legs. What names do we give things? And within those names, what meanings do we contain? And over time, how do those words transform themselves, the world, our lives? It was in the archives of the Royal Museum that I came upon texts written by the first lexicologist to return from the New World. One particular account stuck out to me. He paused in the atrium, its word tank flashing with light. Moroa no longer winced at the dendritic lightning that responded to their voices. The lexicologist leaned against the glass, unseeing. And off the tribes that populated this tributary, I note herein the following vocabularies. The tank felt dark as he recited, sing-song from memory, five strings of words. What does that mean, Moroa said. Are you speaking the words for water, fire, house? For the most part. Five tribes, the scholar of the New World had noted. 3 to 5 words of their language he'd written down. Perhaps they had told him these words, I thought. It wasn't until much later that I realized the truth. Water, fire, house. Water, fire, house, root. Water, fire, house, water, fire, roots, come, water, fire. He licked off a tear that had slid to his lip, straightened up and reached for Moroa's wrist. Moroa allowed him to take her through the coastal hall and down to a narrow corridor to a dead-end cupboard in the wall. He opened it. Moroa frowned at the matchboxes inside. They will molder, she said, reaching out to touch them. The lexicologist picked out a box from near the back, slid it open, and shook out something small, cold, and translucent into Moroa's hand. She rolled it over. It looked like an old tooth. Unga, he said, and the word sputtered faintly. A word for water. When he'd boarded the ship to find these words in the wild, particularly the ones from the list he'd memorized, he hadn't known the people who spoke them were already dead, that all that was left were these incongruent sounds, intermingling with trade speak and the other creoles that he came to learn as he adopted the new world as his own. I was young, he said bitterly. The challenge of piecing together history or culture from a few scant clues, that kept me going. The burden crept up on him later. You've been to the city yourself, and I'm sure you've heard it. Walk any street through the shanties behind the Winter Palace or even the Academy, and you'll hear it. Queen's tongue, like a spider web clinging to words from this world only so long as it takes to replace or forget them. How would you propose to reconstruct a language when all that's left of it is this? He gestured weakly at the matchboxes. This is what we're left of the new world, Maroa, he said, placing the word for water carefully back in its little box. Words for necessary things, the last ones to die. The word child proffers its tendril sibling to the lexicologist, and he can see immediately that this creature is not well. It is somewhat plant-like in form, but its limbs droop and missing words have left it pockmarked. Flakes drop off its extremities and crawl back to its base to coalesce into the main trunk. The word child catches a couple of flakes and puts them to its own face, to where a mouth should be. Stop that, says the lexicologist. The word child spits ineffectually. The flakes have sunk through its face, have already merged with the rest of it. How many like you did she think she could put together, he mutters. This incomplete mess of a thing. He gathers the sickening second mass off the bed and cradles it. The word child's face ripples as he speaks. You understand, don't you? If you once had a name for every rib in your body and one day you wake up and you find you've forgotten the word for the one that's second from the top left, what do you do? In fact, if you've even forgotten the words for right and left, what do you do? The word child's face splits into a grin, an approximation of a mouth that smacks and purses, and then, having mustered some control over these motions, mimics the lexicologist. You do. He bursts into laughter. The word child's mouth widens. Maroa, Maroa, what have you done? He says to it. He drapes her second language across his shoulders, ignoring the bits that drip off. The word child picks up the pieces. He strides across the room for Maroa's hammock. A bed to carry you off, he says, undoing it from the nail she'd hammered into the walls. They return to Maroa's body in silence. The word child stands by its ailing companion while the lexicologist straightens and wraps her body in the rich cloth of the bedspread. He takes care to brush off the ashen corpses of the words that had died upon her mouth and throat. The word child nibbles absently at the tendrils of the second word mass, as if bored of the lexicologist's ministrations. Any last words, he finally says to it. Any last words, the word child parrots. He carries Maroa's body up to the aviary, laboring under her weight. Tomorrow he will go down to the village, he thinks. He cannot remember the last time he left his seclusion. For years, a woman came up to the refuge to deliver his bread and preserves. Maroa had befriended her, and they'd gossiped about his need for a wife. A nurse, I think, is what's actually needed, Maroa had concluded. He places her body down tenderly, as if not to wake her. Clouds obscure the stars, and by the light of the word child, which has followed him, the lexicologist bends over the dead body of his last friend and whispers every word for peace he can remember. The day after the incident with the matchbox cupboard, the lexicologist attempted to salvage the mess of the Eastern Lowlands room, only to find it tidied already. I suppose I should be put away myself in one of those boxes, Maroa said dully, emerging from behind a shelf. The word mass had wrapped itself around her arms. He had poked a sort of head-like shape over her shoulders. She glanced at the creature and said, I tried to persuade it apart, but it does not agree with me. But I'm not feeding it anymore. The lexicologist gave up. It's your language. Do what you will with it, but please don't touch anything else. He retreated to his office to shuffle aimlessly through papers that no longer made sense to him. Maroa knocked on his door and entered. She'd left the word mass behind. I shall leave by the end of the week, she declared. The lexicologist nodded. You have been in education, though you may not believe it. What I want to know, she continued, is what you will do after I'm gone. He shrugged. I have my work, you see. Men with occupations always think they must be doing something worthwhile. If not, they must sweep the floors and brew the soup and call upon their neighbors, and what is the good in that, yes? He wanted to ask her if she thought his work was a waste of time. It was not as if he needed her sanction, but perhaps if she said it out loud, it would finally be true. And that would be something concrete, he thought, for no one spoke their opinions with such conviction as Maroa, who declared those matchboxes coffins and filled with orphans as if they haven't suffered enough, she'd added. She hadn't let him console or persuade her otherwise. I had been talking to myself, Maroa now said. Her hands fumbled absently. I was worried that even if I ever found Bashoa, I wouldn't know what to say, for I had lost the practice of talking to him. And so I found myself in that room, pretending he was there and was just talking, and it felt like I had come home, all the words shining back at me. That's how it began. She threw up her arms. Anyway, that's why I was wondering about what you would do when I'm gone. He opened his mouth, which he hadn't finished. You have been a friend, and you have brought up memories that I'd forgotten. And you're going to save it all from death, you think, because you don't want to accept the obvious. I know, he said. You think this, yes. Have you ever considered opening up a school in this place? Like what those people at the government house do, but with all this. She gestured about her. A refuge, you call it, but from what? And he'd wanted to tell her about how he'd started it all, up here in this high house that overlooked a valley that filled and emptied with clouds, that was so far away from the academy he could almost forget the ringing arguments that had preceded his departure. A school, yes, for children to learn what the academy had already declared uneconomical, uncivil even. And he'd opened the doors and the windows of this great old house, a young lexicologist ablaze with a sense of what was just and necessary, and the children of the village had come traipsing up the slope with their schoolmistress, and he'd ushered them into the atrium with a flourish and a finger to the lips for silence. And when he'd spoken, they'd squealed at the magic tank, forgotten the schoolmistress, and run up and down the stairs of the house, marveling at his shimmery collections. And as they'd laughed and gasped their questions, why, how, their curiosity, their acceptance of every possible cluster of sounds to represent every possible describable thing, their very wonder had set loose the words he'd so carefully catalogued and sent them flying about the house and out the windows like a plague of unnamed spirits. Thank you.
Thank you, Geetha. There we go. Couldn't get my wonderful. Such a perfect story for this evening. I was having a hard time following all the sort of technical things because I was just completely into your story. We have a question from the audience, and as I'm pulling it up, I will remind the audience that you can submit questions using the Q&A feature at the bottom of the screen. But I will start with this one, and then Anastasia will follow with her first question. This comes from Luke. Luke says, I think it was Ezra Pound who said that literature is never created in a vacuum or something like that. And authors oftentimes draw upon literature of the past and present to construct and write their literary worlds. So with that in mind, who would you say are your biggest literary inspirations and how have they influenced your writing? Oh, and make sure you unmute.
That is such a hard question to answer because it's malleable. It changes all the time. The most recent people that I have been thinking about a lot when I write, I actually have Ted Chiang's book, Exhalation, on the side of my my desk right now, and I think his work is incredible. There's a Mexican writer I came across a couple of years ago, Guadalupe Nettel, and her writing is incredible too. She sort of involves natural and domestic lives in this really incredible way. I often find myself sort of reading scientific papers, and I don't want to cite a particular one, but the reason why I do this is because there are people who are exploring the world in ways that are very different from me, and those I find incredibly detailed and rich and inspiring, and so that is constantly influencing what I choose to write about, and so that's something too. I could go on, but it sort of doesn't make sense because it's just sort of what is apparent at the time. And so, yeah.
Anastasia.
Yeah. So in preparation for this reading, I read a story that you had published in Orion magazine. Let me see if I hopefully don't butcher the pronunciation, but I very well might. It's called the Mongerji Letters.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Awesome. Okay, great. I'm glad that I didn't horribly mispronounce it.
It's an invented word.
Oh, well, I'm glad that I was able to pull it together. And kind of off of that story and in reading a kind of a quotation from an editor posted on your website. It was editor Laura Furman who described the story as, quote, constant tension between the timelessness of the strange events and our overwhelming sense that we're watching a dying planet, end quote. So I'm wondering what compelled you to kind of set your writing, maybe generally, or maybe that story specifically, in like a very liminal space where there isn't really like a clear marker of when it takes place, and so why you feel that that applicability to many or all periods is necessary.
Part of the reason why I do that is because I have jumped countries a bunch of times in my life. So I was born in India, and then I grew up in the United Arab Emirates, and then I was in the United States for a few years, and now I live in Panama. And all of these places influence my my writing, the sort of things, that details that I'm picking on. And I don't feel culturally tied to any particular place. I'm sort of, you know, amalgamated. And so decoupling my stories from place helps me find myself within them again, because I don't want to mark a country to which I don't entirely speak to, or a generation or a time that I don't entirely speak to, because I feel like I'm sort of in this floaty space in between. Weirdly, what might often happen is the thing that anchors the story is a biological detail or an ecological detail that would only exist in one part of the world. And that's just something that the people who are reading the story that are, you know, attuned to that would pick up on. But otherwise, it kind of exists in a space that is non-specific, but I don't know, metaphorically real, I guess. Yeah.
Kind of going off that non-specific idea, Rihanna asks, or noted, that you didn't give the lexicologist a name in that story, and wanted to know if there was a reason, if that was an important decision on your part.
Yeah. So the reason why I started writing the story, the first draft of this, a long time ago, was because I had been thinking about dying languages and the last speakers of dying languages, and you know, like every time you read an obituary for one of these people, you know, you're mourning the loss of that person, but you're also mourning the loss of their culture and their worldview and their sense of like cataloging and describing the world. And it felt really weird when I'd finished writing the first draft of the story to have named the people who were saving these languages, but not the people who were dying instead. And so over the courses of redrafting it, I made Moroa sort of the focus in terms of who is named and who is lost. And the lexicologist is just, you know, us who get to speak Queen's tongue and preserve things in the hopes of, you know, maintaining some connection to our more diverse history. So yeah, that's kind of why I did that.
That is very, very cool. Sergey.
So in a way, picking up on that, I'm really always struck when I read your work about the ways in which you defamiliarize language for us. You sort of call our attention to language in the foreground of everything that you're doing, whether it's a piece of fiction or a nonfiction engagement with the natural world. And I wonder if you would talk about that sort of that interest that you have in defamiliarizing language.
Part of it is just, I mean, if you're a writer, you love language, and it's beautiful to see what it means and what you can force it to mean by changing its context. The other part of it is that I really hate that this is my first language. I have lost so much of a connection to my home languages because I've moved. And so even though I speak other languages, I'm not as fluent in them as I would like to be. And so I think that subconsciously, that's something that influences the way that I write in English as well, that this is not the English of someone who has only ever spoken English and thinks it's the only way that you could communicate the world. And yeah, so that's sort of why it happens.
I have another one that sneaked into the chat. Was this particular story inspired by a specific dying language, and how did you come across this idea? I think you've talked a little bit about that already, but the specificities of the language in the story maybe.
Yeah, so there are three things that go into this one. I had read the obituary for Boa Senior, who is the last speaker of the language Bo, which is from the Marshall Islands. This was around the time that I had been thinking about this idea. At the same time, I was at Iowa State University, and I can see that some of my friends are from there, and I just wanted to say hi to them. I was in the library at Iowa State University reading about endangered languages from Peru for some bizarre reason. I don't know the context in which I was reading that, and that's where I came across a literal list of these words that somehow that have incorporated themselves into this story. So that was in Peru. I'd recently been to Panama, and so I was thinking about neotropical landscapes a lot. And my grandmother died, she is one of my strongest connections to the to my first language, Tamil. And so all of those things kind of like interwove together in various ways. And so those were the anchors for the story, even though none of those specifics are there. They're just, you know, like maybe one word or a particular phrase that I kept. I think there's actually a lyric from Boa Senior's one of the recordings of her her singing before she died, and there's a translation of that, and I think that that phrase appears in the story in a different context. So yeah.
Anastasia.
Yeah, so I guess going off of your point in that explanation about like your grandmother passing and that kind of like loss of connection, I guess I'm most familiar with kind of the American iteration of that, and that there is like immigration into the country, and then there is like assimilation into this idea of like American culture and disassociating or distancing oneself from like their home culture. So I wonder if you could also speak to that kind of dimension of your work and the idea of like decolonization within your work as well.
I think so. Part of the way that I think about decolonization is that I write from a perspective of privilege as an Indian, because I don't come from a marginalized community in India. And so even as I'm thinking about decolonization in the English language context for an American language context, I have to be conscious of the fact that I represent a certain level of privilege in India as well. And I don't quite know how to reconcile all of that in text, but it's something that I'm trying to learn how to do and read other people that would help me figure that out. So yeah.
Someone else was noting what a wonderful story it was, and they mentioned the way that language so directly intervenes in the material world reminds them of one of their favorite novels, China Miéville's Embassy Town. Can you talk about how your work thinks about the relationship between signs and material possibility?
Yes. In the context of how language works, there is no material reality in how language operates on you. It's very contextual and symbolic, but if it moves you and it's true to you, that is a kind of immaterial reality that's meaningful. And it's not something that you can artificially create. So I don't know if that's really the right answer to the question or if it addresses it, but that is about as close as I would get to answering that interesting question.
Thank you. Sergey.
I suppose I'd like to follow up on that and just ask if you think that creative writing then, writing imaginatively, writing creatively, becomes a kind of an intervention in a sense when you're talking about the discourses of science. I guess this goes back also to the decolonization question that Anastasia asked. Is creative work in a way a sort of an opportunity to destabilize the claims of authority and so on that are present in those kinds of narratives?
Yeah, I think you would hope that that is true. I think that the other part of this thing is who's listening. And whether they're actually going to seek out the kind of work that could potentially destabilize their given understanding of the world, and so I don't want to give creative writing in itself too much power that way, because it kind of depends on who it goes to. But I think that the other thing that it does, just at least for like the people who write it, it's a form of it's a form of certainty and a form of kinship with what you care about that is, I think, really meaningful. And it can be empowering for yourself, even if not for a wider audience. And then hopefully you find the three friends who feel similarly through that, and then it connects. Yeah.
Aaron asks if you can talk a bit about how you work on your wide variety of projects. So for example, does your poetry feed your nonfiction, or do you put down one project in order to pick up another?
I usually have a bunch of projects working side by side with each other, just because I'm something of a magpie, like a research magpie and a work magpie, and I'm flitting back and forth between things, and some things that seem right as fiction one day might feel better as poetry the other day. And right now, one of the things that's happening is that because everyone has got pandemic brain, and I have that too, I'm increasingly fragmented in my ability to focus, and it's particularly useful to be able to just like dip a toe into this idea that I had for a nonfiction piece and not think too seriously about like what is the big picture, because I can always dip into something else later because my mind's not there, because whose mind is there right now? So, yeah.
Anastasia, do you have another question?
Yeah, I guess just kind of looking at what's available in the Q&A, someone asks the parallel between the lexicology of emojis and your writing. And that prompted for me kind of an idea of how our like culture, as it becomes increasingly like globalized, and like everyone's culture becomes increasingly globalized with like technology as a means of like intervening with how we communicate. I'm wondering what your relationship or thoughts are also on like how images fit into your language, if you feel like building up like, well, obviously literary fiction is very reliant upon images, but just how you feel that that also connects with your work and how you want things to perceive, if you feel that you can control how readers perceive your work, and so on and so forth.
I think like visuals are sort of the natural thing that you would go to as a writer, because most of us communicate or interpret the world visually. But I think one of the nice things about writing something down is that on a certain level, I'm hoping that someone's going to hear it as well. So I try to move away from visuals or try to describe things that you couldn't see and pin down sounds that you might not otherwise. And I don't know how successful that works, but that's something that's on the back of my mind. And I think, yeah, it's something that I try to do with the work that I with the work that I produce. I haven't ever published visual text hybrids, but that's something that I would really like to do, because I feel like when you do that, you allow these two media to speak to each other without having to repeat what they're saying, and you cannot process without consuming both those things at the same time. And so thinking in a multimedia context is something that I would like to do, but right now I just sort of like hint at like a number of my stories feature artists, because I don't have the means at the moment to draw or sculpt, but I want to feature that way of responding to the world. And so it's sort of like living vicariously through the text in someone who is responding through images.
Can you think of an author who has done that in a way that you would love to be able to, the mixing of the media and the text?
Let's see. Xing Yin Kor is a graphic artist, sculptor, illustrator. They do a combination of things, and I follow them on Twitter, and I think that their work is incredible, and it's this sort of like mythic world that is also then highly detailed with like little maps and illustrations and things like that. And so their work inspires me in a lot of ways. They came out with a travelogue on the American road experience, I think traveling route, what is it, Route 66, is that the right one? And it's sort of like the exploration of the Asian American experience through a road trip through the United States. And their work is really great.
Thank you. I have a question from Liv in the audience. How have your personal curiosities and intense scientific obsessions shaped your narrative voice and the projects you choose to pursue, especially regarding the way you prepare and research?
I think this is sort of like the magpie brain at work again, is that if I find something that is weirdly interesting only to me, I then fall into a research hole about it. And it's my version of, I don't know, like, it's just geekiness basically. And then like finding a way to turn it into something that someone might publish one day. Like I get very nerdy about research, about things that are inherently fascinating, but most of the time we don't have time to pay attention to those things. So yeah.
Sergey, do you have any thoughts, questions?
So I actually have a question about one of the subjects that you explore in your collection of essays, which is novel ecosystems. Mm-hmm. Am I right in understanding that that's sort of a space that's simultaneously both like natural and shaped by human hands? Yes. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm wondering if that actually offers a kind of an interesting metaphor, if we sort of snatch that away from the scientists for just a moment. Mm-hmm. An interesting metaphor for the relationship between the real and the imagined in your vast kind of different sorts of work that you do. I wonder if you'd talk about that a little bit.
Yeah. I don't know if I would say real and imagined so much. I would say the conventional way in which we think of our worlds versus the way they actually are. The way that scientists will try to talk about novel ecosystems to you, there's this underlying current of like, we have made the world the way it is. You cannot go back. You cannot go to some imagined state of pristine wilderness. You cannot decouple humans from their cities. You cannot stop people from traveling across borders. And therefore you cannot stop all of the other organisms that intermix with them. Cities are ecosystems. They are very urban. They are very anthropogenic, but they are ecosystems. They live because of the fact that we live and we need things to support ourselves, whether or not we bring them in with pipes or whether we are farming them ourselves. And so to stop thinking of humans as separate from nature is part of the project of thinking about novel ecosystems. And so I think that like more acceptance of like the reality of our lives is we live in manipulated landscapes, and to think consciously about how we are manipulating those landscapes is sort of the only way forward. We're living through a mass extinction and we're living through climate change. We are incapable individually of fixing those problems, but if we collectively have an imagination of like how we try to, I don't know, like keep the sputtering, like, you know, airship that's falling apart still in the air with all of the glue that fits it together, keep some parts of it together, that is part of the imagination of thinking about, you know, like living as a subunit of nature rather than apart from it. So that's sort of where I fall in that big theoretical space.
Yeah, this next question comes from Andrew, and it actually is tying into this landscape and language that you're talking about right now, but specifically to this story. Andrew says, can you discuss further the connections between your lexicologist and the ongoing study of lost or endangered ecosystems, species, or landscapes that are the subject of biodiversity scientists? What is the connection between language and landscape in this story?
I think one of the inherent connections is that people have always lived in connection with their landscape and have found ways to name and make sense of those landscapes. But as we colonize those landscapes, we extirpate the people who first created knowledge systems for those places. And in manipulating those ecosystems, we depopulate them off their original living inhabitants, and especially their original, the people who lived there. And so when I think about the lexicologist trying to preserve dying languages, to do that without the context of celebrating the people who speak those languages and creating a system where they continue to be able to name and classify their worlds and tell their stories in their languages, that is still a documentation of an extinction process, which is what we do with, you know, like witnessing the last thylacine, for example, which may or may not have reemerged, or I don't know if you're following the Twitter discourse on this, but like, you know, all of the species that are going out on our watch, we document them with just enough time to say we should care, but then, you know, institutionally, we don't have the means to actually protect the worlds in which they live. So yeah, I think that those two things are connected in terms of like wanting to document, but then not having enough people to be like, experience is also a document, and, you know, things need to exist, whether or not you have a desire to say that they are special.
Anastasia, do you have any other questions?
Yeah, let me see here. So I guess this is kind of veering back towards the story that you've read for us, but there's a scene towards the end of it in which the kind of children take the words that are very like nicely cataloged and kind of just really wreak havoc with all of them. So I'm wondering if you can talk about maybe like how age and plays into this, and maybe along with that, like how time works with your own kind of writing, mm-hmm. and potentially as well, like, no, I'll just leave it at that. Yeah, how age and time kind of plays with chaos unfolding.
The first part of that question is relatively easy to answer, in that when I was thinking about dying languages, I was also thinking about the fact that we are innately capable of learning any language if that is the first one that we're exposed to. So I was thinking that part of the magic of this world that has been forgotten by most people is the fact that you could have kept it alive if there were children around to pass it on to sort of like engage with it on a in an organic way. And like part of the thing that happens with these languages sort of like melding together is kind of what young people do with languages. They amalgamate. Languages don't maintain their boundaries when they're made, you know, when they're brought in contact with each other. And that's part of the organic growth that happens. And so that was part of the reason why those children appeared. The other part of the question, time, I don't know how to answer how time operates in my stories. It kind of would depend on whether I was concerned with a single day or a lifetime, and how I chose to how much time I chose to devote to that. Is there a way that you could sort of like recontextualize the second part of your question for me?
I guess, like, again, just going back to the fact that it was like kind of kids figuring this out and kind of the ones making a mess. Maybe just, oh gosh, I guess just like, yeah, I don't really know either. We've just kind of landed in a fun little like liminal, like unknown space. I don't know if we have anything else more on like age you want to elaborate on, but yeah, I apologize. I can't really like contextualize it, unfortunately, but.
No, that's fine. It's, yeah. I think one of the things that happened when I was writing this story is that obviously it's going flashing back and forth in time, and the present day narrative occurs just in like 24 hours while the lexicologist is trying to figure out how to deal with Moroa's body, and the past is just going back and back into like the 6 months that Moroa is there with him, but also like her childhood and her experiences of her brother, and then his childhood and his sense of like why he wanted to do the things that he wanted to do. And I kind of wanted to put those two things in the same space, because you can't really appreciate the loss that accompanies a death without exploring the life in some way. And so giving those two things equal weight maybe had something to do with sort of signaling that, you know, the death is still real. The death is still the thing that we are left with, and we have to figure out how okay we are with that. So, yeah.
I'm gonna wrap us up with one more question. Anastasia brought up liminal space, hard to say. And there's a question from the audience or a comment about how vibrantly you describe space in your literature. So the question is, what processes do you use and what thoughts go through your mind when you're trying to conceptualize the idea of space and time in your literature?
a lot of times it comes from, and I think this depends on each writer, but for me, a lot of times this comes from a visual or like a snippet or a half dream that I had that seems like intense and necessary to explore further. And in the context of this story, it was an old man pinning things like insects into the pages of an old ledger and two little girls coming up to him and laughing and all of it flying in his face. That was just this visual that I had. And then the story came out of that. But the other part of it is also being in physical spaces that I find are inspiring and that I want to put back into fiction in some way. And living in Panama had a huge influence on the way in which this particular story worked out in terms of like the physicality of certain trees that appear in the early parts of the story, or like the ways in which the insects, or not the insects, but the words move in ways that are similar to insects and stuff like that. And then like, you know, like the times that I've occupied, the spaces that I've occupied in libraries or in laboratories often end up then informing the spaces that I then want to write about, which is about people who are trying very meticulously to do something that nobody else has the patience for. And so, yeah, that's sort of what I tap into.
Thank you, Geetha. This has been a lovely evening. And thank you, Sergey and Anastasia, for helping. Geetha, I was just thinking, I'm so glad that you're the Mellon Science and Nature Writing Fellow for 2 years. So this is our first year of exposure to you, but I look forward to exchanges in the future as well. And thank you, audience, for joining us for this evening. Wonderful questions, and they were fun to read on your behalf. And yeah, we appreciate you all, and we wish you health and good rest.
Thank you all so much.
Thank you.